Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Age of Entanglement, When Quantum Physics Was Reborn, by Louisa Gilder, read by Walter Dixon. A Note to the Reader. Werner Heisenberg, the pioneer who first laid down the laws of the fundamental behavior of matter and light, was an old man when he sat down to write about his life. The book he wrote is not an autobiography of the man, but an autobiography of his intellect, entirely a series of reconstructed conversations. His two most famous papers are solo affairs, one introducing quantum mechanics, the laws of the fundamental behavior of matter and light, and the other on the uncertainty principle, which declares that at any given time, the more specific a particle's position, the more vague its speed and direction, and vice versa. But the roots of each solitary paper reach deep into months of heated and careful conversation with most of the great names of quantum physics. "Science rests on experiments," wrote Heisenberg, "but science is rooted in conversations." Nothing could be further from the impression physics textbooks give to students. There, physics seems to be a perfect sculpture, sitting in a vacuum-sealed case, as if brains, only tenuously connected to bodies, had given birth to insights fully formed. These Athena-like theories and Zeus-like theorists seem shiny, glassy smooth. Sometimes, if the light is right, you can see through them into the mysteries and beauties of the physical universe. But there is hardly a trace of humanity, or any sense of questions still to be answered. Physics, in actuality, is a never-ending search made by human beings. Gods and angels do not come bearing perfectly formed theories to disembodied prophets who instantly write textbooks. The schoolbook simplifications obscured the crooked, strange, and fascinating paths that stretch out from each idea, not only back into the past, but also onward into the future. While we aspire to universality and perfection, we are lying if we write as if we have achieved it. Conversations are essential to science, but the off-the-cuff nature of conversation poses a difficulty. It is rare, even in these digital times, to have a complete transcript of every word spoken between two people on a given day, even if that conversation someday leads to a new understanding of the world. The result is that history books rarely have much of the to and fro of human interaction. Heisenberg's statement suggests that something is therefore lost. When I first started poring through the memoirs and biographies of the quantum physicists of the 20th century, I felt as if I were watching a movie. The cast of characters was so vivid and the plot twist so unexpected. While the strength of science is its ability to slough off the contingencies of history and reach toward pure knowledge, this knowledge is built, one puzzle piece at a time, by people living their lives in specific times and places with specific passions. Science unfolds in some directions rather than in others because of circumstances. Characters, not disembodied brains, and plot twists, not the relentless forward march of truth, almost guarantee that this is true. As Tom Wolfe wrote at the beginning of The Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test, "I have tried not only to tell what the pranksters did, but to recreate the mental atmosphere, or subjective reality of it. I don't think their adventure can be understood without that." Wolfe was recounting a very different kind of mental history, but his point, I find, is even more true about the portentous history of science and intellect that unfolded as the Age of Entanglement. This is an audiobook of conversations, an audiobook about how the give and take between physicists repeatedly changed the direction in which quantum physics developed, just as conversations, subtly or dramatically, change the world we live in and experience every day. All the conversations in this audio program occurred in some form, on the date specified in the text, and I have fully documented the substance of every one. Most are composed of direct quotes, or close paraphrases, from the trove of letters, papers, and memoirs that these physicists left behind. When occasional connective tissue, for example, "nice to see you," or "I agree," was necessary, I tried to keep it both innocuous and also sensitive to the character, beliefs, and history of the people involved. Here is a sample from the text from a conversation that took place in the summer of 1923 on a streetcar in Copenhagen between two of the founders of quantum theory, Albert Einstein and Niels Bohr, and its first great teacher, Arnold Sommerfeld. "It's good to see you doing so well," says Einstein. Bohr shakes his head, smiling. "My life, from the scientific point of view, passes off in periods of overhappiness and despair, as I know that both of you understand, of feeling vigorous and overworked, of starting papers and not getting them published." His face is earnest. "Because all the time I am gradually changing my views about this terrible riddle which the quantum theory is." "I know." Einstein's eyes almost close. He is nodding. "That is a wall before which I am stopped. The difficulties are terrible." His eyes open. "The theory of relativity was only a sort of respite which I gave myself during my struggles with the quanta." We know that the conversation, of which this interchange represents a tiny piece, happened because Bohr mentioned it in an interview late in his life with his son and one of his closest colleagues. The content of the conversation is easy to gather from a look at what the three men were working on and writing friends about around the same time. Here, Bohr, in the interview, describes that day in 1923. "Sommerfeld was not impractical, not quite impractical. But Einstein was not more practical than I, and when he came to Copenhagen, I naturally fetched him from the railway station. We took the streetcar from the station and talked so animatedly about things that we went much too far past our destination. So we got off and went back. Thereafter, we again went too far. I can't remember how many stops, but we rode back and forth in the streetcar because Einstein was really interested at that time. We don't know whether his interest was more or less skeptical, but in any case, we went back and forth many times in the streetcar, and what people thought of us, that is something else." Here is the first quote on which this particular short section of the conversation is based. It comes from a letter Bohr wrote to a British colleague in August of 1918. "I know that you understand how my life, from the scientific point of view, passes off in periods of overhappiness and despair, of feeling vigorous and overworked, of starting papers and not getting them published, because all the time I am gradually changing my views about this terrible riddle which the quantum theory is." How can a passage written 5 years earlier be relevant? Some things had changed for Bohr in the intervening years, but what he touches on in the letter had remained the same. The excitement, dejection, and overwork during this whole period he was building his Institute of Physics in Copenhagen, the long, arduous papers only partially published, and, most of all, his struggle to understand the quantum theory, which, until Heisenberg's breakthrough in 1925, stood on shifting sand. Here is the second quote, from a journey by train taken a year before. "The astronomer of the Paris Observatory rode with Einstein from Belgium to Paris and asked him about the quantum problem." "That is a wall before which one is stopped," Einstein replied. "The difficulties are terrible. For me, the theory of relativity was only a sort of respite which I gave myself during their examination." His opinions on the subject were the same at the time of our scene in the summer of 1923. By the following summer, an unexpected letter from India would help him chip a crack in this quantum wall. As for the filler, Bohr was the kind of person whose happiness was infectious. He would indeed have been looking well when he picked up Einstein to show him his newly completed institute, no matter how overworked and secretly despairing he might actually be. And Sommerfeld, always intellectually engaged with Bohr during those early years of the quantum theory, would have known intimately what Bohr meant by this terrible riddle. I believe the risks of telling the story in this way are outweighed by the reward, a sense of how, through minds meeting minds, the quantum theory unfolded. I am hopeful of earning your trust and of honoring Heisenberg's sense of how science is really done. LG, October 17, 2007. Postscript. The risks of telling the story in this way have recently been highlighted. In the note to the reader, I had picked an example that would bring to the fore the speculative, collage-like nature of the conversations in the audiobook. So, it is not such a surprise that this example I used was the one which proved to conflict partially with further research. Sommerfeld, it turns out, was not in the streetcar with Bohr that day in 1923. And in fact, neither was Einstein. Bohr told the story of his streetcar ride with Einstein in the course of a rambling conversation during a long Scandinavian summer day at his New Zealand beach house half a century ago. It was the 12th of July, 1961, and Bohr was almost 76. He would die in the next year. His son, Olga, and his most devoted assistant, Leon Rosenfeld, were interviewing him. Bohr guessed that Einstein had come after giving a speech in the Swedish town of Göteborg, which was 1923, when the town celebrated its 300th anniversary. But the Bohr archive, comparing notes with the Einstein archive, now believes that Einstein visited Copenhagen only once, in 1920, after a speaking trip to Christiania, as Oslo was called until 1924, in honor of a long-ago Norwegian and Danish king. Immediately afterwards, Einstein wrote to his father figure, the great Dutch physicist Hendrik Lorentz. The trip to Christiania was really beautiful. The most beautiful were the hours I spent with Bohr in Copenhagen. He is a highly gifted and excellent man. It is a good omen for physics that prominent physicists are mostly also splendid people. Einstein and Bohr's biographer, Abraham Pice, wrote in Niels Bohr's Times, page 228, "I have not found any comment by Bohr on this visit." It is rather nice to realize now that Bohr's streetcar story is, in fact, describing those beautiful hours. Sommerfeld's name came into Bohr's telling of this tale, not because he was there, as I had believed, but because talking of those events brought him to Bohr's mind. Bohr, Sommerfeld, and Einstein in those days were in close communication. Bohr and Sommerfeld as they elaborated their atomic model, and Einstein and Sommerfeld as they discussed general relativity during its genesis. The 20 years between 1908 and 1928 were Sommerfeld's heyday as a mathematical physicist, during which he supervised the PhD theses of an incredible total of 4 future Nobel laureates. What, then, in 1920, would have engrossed Einstein and Bohr so much that they repeatedly missed their stop? Well, the focus of their discussions and disagreements in 1920 was the same as in 1923, the light quantum. All of which is to say that the mission of this audiobook is to complement the existing histories and textbooks with a reminder of the wonderful unsettledness of conversation, interchange, and experiment, and the moments in which these occasionally flash into inspired clarity. This audiobook is a celebration of the glorious human mess that incubates discovery, as well as of its flawed and heroic searchers. LG, March 25, 2009. Introduction. Entanglement. Anytime two entities interact, they entangle. It doesn't matter if they are photons, bits of light, atoms, bits of matter, or bigger things made of atoms, like dust motes, microscopes, cats, or people. The entanglement persists no matter how far these entities separate, as long as they don't subsequently interact with anything else, an almost impossibly tall order for a cat or a person, which is why we don't notice the effect. But the motions of subatomic particles are dominated by entanglement. It starts when they interact. In doing so, they lose their separate existence. No matter how far they move apart, if one is tweaked, measured, observed, the other seems to instantly respond, even if the whole world now lies between them, and no one knows how. Strange as it seems, this kind of correlation is happening all the time, and we know it happens because of the work of John Bell. Raised in the chaos of Ireland during the Second World War, he spent his working years in peaceful Switzerland and died just after his 62nd birthday, the year, unbeknownst to him, that he was nominated for the Nobel Prize. He called the work for which he is now most famous his hobby, probing into the logical foundations of quantum mechanics. His second paper on this subject, in 1964, briefly and beautifully demonstrates the utter lack of any common-sense mechanism to correlate these entangled particles. Bell had extended and deepened a hitherto sneered-at paper of Einstein's on the subject, written in 1935 with two little-known colleagues, Boris Podolsky and Nathan Rosen. 40 years after its rehabilitation by John Bell, the paper is, by a massive margin, the most cited of all Einstein's roster of glittering, earth-shaking work, and the most cited paper of the dominant physics journal of the second half of the 20th century, Physical Review. Entanglement's presence, especially over tiny distances, for example, with a hydrogen molecule, began to be manifest in the early 20th century, in the springtime of the quantum theory. But it was Bell, with his simple algebra and deep thinking, who laid open the central paradox. The mysteries embedded in quantum mechanics provoked four major reactions from its founders: orthodoxy, heresy, agnosticism, and simple misunderstanding. Three of the theory's founders, Bohr, Heisenberg, and Wolfgang Pauli interpretation. Three more founders, including Einstein, were heretics, believing that something was rotten in the quantum theory they had played such a role in developing. Finally, pragmatic people said, "The time is not yet ripe for understanding these things," and confused people dismissed the mysteries with simplistic explanations. This riot of different reactions had a huge impact on the future of quantum mechanics because the theory needed interpretation the way a fish needs water. This fact alone was a drastic break with the past history of science. A classical, that is, pre-quantum equation, after its terms were defined, essentially explained itself. With the quantum revolution, the equations fell silent. Only an interpretation allowed them to speak about the natural world. Take this analogy. A Bhutanese artist, flown to the Metropolitan Museum of Art and introduced to Western painting for the first time, would have no problem understanding the essentials of the gory story represented by any of the several paintings of Judith, sword in one elegant hand, the head of Holofernes swinging from the other. Before 1900, a painting could be relied on to speak about what the painter intended. Standing in the Guggenheim, before a series of swathes of browns that give an impression of motion, however, our Bhutanese artist will be pardoned for glancing quickly over to the little title card, in a now universal art gallery ritual, to find out that this is actually a sad young man on a train. More scandalous than any Jewish maiden carrying a severed head, the companion painting to the sad young man, Marcel Duchamp's famous Nude Descending a Staircase, which rocked the New York art world in 1913, graces the cover of one of Heisenberg's books. Quantum mechanics represented a perfectly contemporaneous and analogous break with the past. Just as much as the paintings of Duchamp and his successors, quantum mechanics needed that little title card to connect with a reality outside its beautiful mathematics. And in the 1920s and 30s, physicists argued over who would get to script it. Here are the protagonists. 1. The Copenhagen interpretation. Niels Bohr, a lifelong friend and intellectual adversary of Einstein's, who founded the Institute for Theoretical Physics in Copenhagen, tried to make sense of the mysteries with a concept he called complementarity. For Bohr, complementarity was an almost religious belief that the paradoxes of the quantum world must be accepted as fundamental, not to be solved or trivialized by attempts to find out what's really going on down there. Bohr used the word in an unusual way. The complementarity of waves and particles, for example, or of position and momentum, meant that when one existed fully, its complement did not exist at all. In order to take this view, Bohr emphasized There has to be a big classical world, devoid of complementarity. The world of circling planets and falling apples that Isaac Newton had explained so well, which serves as a platform from which to stare into the quantum abyss. In fact, instead of thinking of classical-sized things, like apples and cats, as being made of quantum things, like atoms, Bohr put the dependence the other way. In his famous Como lecture of 1927, he emphasized that waves and particles are abstractions, their properties being definable and observable only through their interaction with other systems. And these other systems must be classical, like a measuring apparatus. Rather than urging physicists to find a way to move beyond such abstractions to a more accurate description, Bohr further insisted that these abstractions are indispensable to describe experience in connection with our ordinary space-time view. That is, quantum things must be talked about in a classical language, ill-suited to describe them, and the existence of any property we can recognize in a quantum object must always depend upon finding another system that will interact with it in a classical way. Classical systems are, paradoxically, necessary to describe the quantum systems of which they are made. His enthusiastic supporter, Werner Heisenberg, and best critic, Wolfgang Pauli, would go so far as to say that the quantum world is, in a certain way, created or transformed by our observation of it, since the atom seems to have no properties before measurement. Those who are not shocked when they first come across quantum theory, said Bohr in conversation with Heisenberg and Pauli, cannot possibly have understood it. 2. Something is rotten. Starting in 1909, only 9 years after quantum theory's tentative debut, Albert Einstein began to worry that it implied a world composed of non-separable pieces that were not mutually independent. When he tried to treat the individual particles as individuals, they seemed to exert a mutual influence of a quite mysterious nature on each other, or even seemed to affect each other in what he ridiculed as spooky action at a distance, or a sort of telepathic coupling. To him, it was clear that this meant a fatal flaw in the theory. Erwin Schrödinger showed that, on its face, the quantum theory, and in particular its foundational equation that bears his name, leads to a bizarre paradox. If we do not firmly declare with Bohr that something big, like a cat, does not follow the laws of quantum mechanics, though it is indubitably constructed of particles that do, we can prove the cat to be alive and dead simultaneously. Schrödinger yearned to reject the Copenhagen dualism and believe in a single world described by his equation, but could never find a way to do it. Louis de Broglie, a young Frenchman, came up with a version of the quantum theory in which the Schrödinger equation describes a long-range force that moves faster than the speed of light, spookily guiding the particles that make up our world. This kind of interpretation is an example of what is commonly called hidden variables. The concept to remember and link with this opaque designation, in the case of de Broglie's version of it, is a quantum theory without observers. A quantum theory where the reality of particles does not depend on whether they are observed. 3. The time is not ripe. Paul Dirac, always known in public life by his first initials, PAM, whose equation describing electrons was one of the most astonishingly powerful results of the quantum theory, felt that it was too soon to be wasting time worrying about entanglement. It would make sense someday. 4. Dismissive incomprehension. Max Born, like Bohr, a lifelong friend of Einstein's and contributor to the Copenhagen interpretation, could never understand why the others thought the meaning of the theory was such an important and difficult issue. After the 1930s, it seemed clear that the analyses of Einstein, Schrödinger, and de Broglie were dead ends, and in fact, most of the great and lasting triumphs of the quantum theory did come from one of the other schools of thought. But no one following Bohr, Heisenberg, Pauli, Dirac, or Born dared grasp, measure, or even name the deepest of all the puzzles, entanglement. Then along came John Bell. An admirer of Einstein, Schrödinger, and de Broglie, he followed their minority views to their natural conclusions and brought unexpected clarity where before there had been fog. And what the fog had been hiding was vividly and wonderfully strange. Bohr used to say, "Truth and clarity are complementary," meaning that the more truthful you try to be, the more unclear will be your statements, and vice versa. This was certainly true of Bohr himself, but Bell wasn't buying it. As he once told one of Bohr's most famous post-war disciples, John Wheeler, "I'd rather be clear and wrong than foggy and right." Bohr's books and papers, full of careful prohibitions about what cannot be contemplated and obscure statements about complementarity, indivisibility, and irrationality, have become holy writ to be interpreted and reinterpreted by each new generation of physicists. From the point of view of the history of entanglement, they are not worth one clear sentence from Einstein, Schrödinger, de Broglie, or John Bell, who each said, in a way that opened up a new world, "Hey, look at this." Chapter 1. The Socks, 1978 and 1981. In 1978, when John Bell first met Reinhold Bertelmann at the weekly tea party at the Organisation Européenne pour la Recherche Nucléaire near Geneva, he could not know that the thin young Austrian, smiling at him through a short black beard, was wearing mismatched socks. And Bertelmann did not notice the characteristically logical extension of Bell's vegetarianism: plastic shoes. Deep under the ground beneath these two pairs of maverick feet, ever-increasing magnetic fields were accelerating protons, pieces of the tiny center of the atom, around and around a donut-shaped track a quarter of a kilometer in diameter. Studying these particles was part of the daily work of CERN, as the organization was called. A tangled history left the acronym no longer correlated with the name. In the early 1950s, at the age of 25, Bell had acted as consultant to the team that designed this subterranean accelerator, christened in scientific pseudo-Greek the proton synchrotron. In 1960, the Irish physicist returned to Switzerland to live with his Scottish wife, Mary, also a physicist and a designer of accelerators. CERN's charmless, colorless campus of box-shaped buildings with protons flying through their foundations became Bell's intellectual home for the rest of his life, in the green pastureland between Geneva and the mountains. At such a huge and impersonal place, Bell believed, newcomers should be welcomed. He had never seen Bertelmann before, and so he walked up to him and said, his brogue still clear despite almost two decades in Geneva, "I'm John Bell." This was a familiar name to Bertelmann. Familiar, in fact, to almost anyone who studied the high-speed crashes and collisions taking place under Bell's and Bertelmann's feet. In other words, the disciplines known as particle physics and quantum field theory. Bell had spent the last quarter of a century conducting piercing investigations into these flying, decaying, and shattering particles. Like Sherlock Holmes, he focused on details others ignored and was wont to make startlingly clear and unexpected assessments. He did not like to take commonly held views for granted, but tended to ask, "How do you know?" said his professor, Sir Rudolf Pyrrhels, a great physicist of the previous generation. John always stood out through his ability to penetrate to the bottom of any argument, an early co-worker remembered, and to find the flaws in it by very simple reasoning. His papers, numbering over 100 by 1978, were an inventory of such questions answered and flaws or treasures discovered as a result. Bertelmann already knew this, and that Bell was a theorist with an almost quaint sense of responsibility who shied away from grand speculations and rooted himself in what was directly related to experiments at CERN. Yet it was this same responsibility that would not let him ignore what he called a rottenness or a dirtiness in the foundations of quantum mechanics, the theory with which they all worked. probing the weak points of these foundations, the places in the plumbing where the theory was, as he put it, unprofessional, occupied Bell's free time. Had those in the lab known of this hobby, almost none of them would have approved. But on a sabbatical in California in 1964, 6,000 miles from his responsibilities at CERN, Bell had made a fascinating discovery down there in the plumbing of the theory. Revealed in that extraordinary paper of 1964, Bell's theorem showed that the world of quantum mechanics, the base upon which the world we see is built, is composed of entities that are either, in the jargon of physics, not locally causal, not fully separable, or even not real unless observed. If the entities of the quantum world are not locally causal, then an action like measuring a particle can have instantaneous, spooky effects across the universe. As for separability, without such an assumption of the mutually independent existence, the being thus, of spatially distant things, Einstein insisted, physical thought in the sense familiar to us would not be possible. Nor does one see how physical laws could be formulated and tested without such a clean separation. The most extreme version of non-separability is the idea that the quantum entities do not become solid until they are observed, like the proverbial tree that makes no sound when it falls unless a listener is around. Einstein found the implications ludicrous. Do you really believe the moon is not there if nobody looks? Up to that point, the idea of science rested on separability, as Einstein had said. It could be summarized as humankind's long intellectual journey away from magic, not locally causal, and from anthropocentrism, not real unless observed. Perversely, and to the consternation of Bell himself, his theorem brought physics to the point where it seemingly had to choose between these absurdities. Whatever the ramifications, it would become obvious by the beginning of this century that Bell's paper had caused a sea change in physics. But in 1978, the paper, published 14 years before in an obscure journal, was still mostly unknown. Bertelmann looked with interest at his new acquaintance, who was smiling affably with eyes almost shut behind big metal-rimmed glasses. Bell had red hair that came down over his ears, not flaming red, but what was known in his native country as ginger, and a short beard. His shirt was brighter than his hair, and he wore no tie. In his painstaking Viennese-inflected English, Bertelmann introduced himself. "I'm Reinhold Bertelmann, a new fellow from Austria." Bell's smile broadened. "Oh, and what are you working on?" It turned out that they were both engaged with the same calculations dealing with quarks, the tiniest bits of matter. They found they had come up with the same results. Bell, by one method on his desktop calculator, Bertelmann, by the computer program he had written. So began a happy and fruitful collaboration. And one day, Bell happened to notice Bertelmann's socks. 3 years later, in an austere room high up in one of the majestic stone buildings of the University of Vienna, Bertelmann was curled over the screen of one of the physics department's computers, deep in the world of quarks, thinking not in words but in equations. His computer, at 15 feet by 6 feet by 6 feet, one of the department's smaller ones, almost filled the room. Despite the early spring chill, the air conditioning ran, fighting the heat produced by the sweatings and whirrings of the behemoth. Occasionally, Bertelmann fitted a new punch card perforated with a line of code. He had been at his work for hours as the sunlight moved silently around the room. He didn't look up at the sound of someone's practiced fingers poking the buttons that unlocked the door, nor when it swung open. Gerhard Ecker, from across the hall, was coming straight at him, a sheaf of papers in hand. He was the university's man in charge of receiving preprints, papers that have yet to be published, which authors send to scientists whose work is related to their own. Ecker was laughing. "Bertelmann!" he shouted, even though he was not 4 feet away. Bertelmann looked up bemused as Ecker thrust a preprint into his hands. "You're famous now!" The title, as Bertelmann surveyed it, read, "Bertelmann's Socks and the Nature of Reality, J.S. Bell, CERN, Geneva, Switzerland. The article was slated for publication in a French physics periodical, Journal de Physique, later in 1981. Its title was almost as incomprehensible to Bertelmann as it would be for a casual reader. "But what's this about? What possibly..." Ecker said, "Read it. Read it." He read. The philosopher in the street, who has not suffered a course in quantum mechanics, is quite unimpressed by Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen correlations. He can point to many examples of similar correlations in everyday life. The case of Bertelmann's socks is often cited. "My socks? What is he talking about? And EPR correlations? It's a big joke. John Bell is playing a big published joke on me." EPR, short for the paper's authors, Albert Einstein, Boris Podolsky, and Nathan Rosen, was, like Bell's 1964 theorem, which it inspired 30 years later, something of an embarrassment for physics. To the question posed by their title, "Can quantum mechanical description of physical reality be considered complete?" Einstein and his lesser-known cohorts answered, "No." They brought to the attention of physicists the existence of a mystery in the quantum theory. Two particles that had once interacted could, no matter how far apart, remain entangled, the word Schrödinger coined in that same year, 1935, to describe this mystery. A rigorous application of the laws of quantum mechanics seemed to force the conclusion that measuring one particle affected the state of the second one, acting on it at a great distance by those spooky means. Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen therefore felt that quantum mechanics would be superseded by some future theory that would make sense of the case of the correlated particles. Physicists around the world had barely looked up from their calculations. Years went by, and it became more and more obvious that despite some odd details, ignored like the eccentricities of a general who was winning a war, quantum mechanics was the most accurate theory in the history of science. But John Bell was a man who noticed details, and he noticed that the EPR paper had not been satisfactorily dealt with. Bertelmann felt like laughing in confusion. He looked at Ecker, who was grinning. "Read on, read on." Dr. Bertelmann likes to wear two socks of different colors. Which color he will have on a given foot on a given day is quite unpredictable. But when you see figure one, that the first sock is pink. What is figure one? My socks? Bertelmann ruffled through the pages and found, appended at the end, a little line sketch of the kind John Bell was fond of doing. He read on. "But when you see that the first sock is pink, you can be already sure that the second sock will not be pink. Observation of the first and experience of Bertelmann give immediate information about the second. There is no accounting for tastes, but apart from that, there is no mystery here. And is not the EPR business just the same?" Bertelmann imagined John's voice saying this, conjured up his amused face. "For 3 years we worked together every day, and he never said a thing." Ecker was laughing. "What do you think?" Bertelmann had already dashed past him, out the door, down the hall, to the phone, and with trembling fingers was calling CERN. Bell was in his office when the phone rang, and Bertelmann came on the line, completely incoherent. "What have you done? What have you done?" Bell's clear laugh alone, so familiar and matter-of-fact, was enough to bring the world into focus again. Then Bell said, enjoying the whole thing, "Now you are famous, Reinhold. But what is this paper about? Is this a big joke?" "Read the paper, Reinhold, and tell me what you think." A tigress paces before a mirror. Her image, down to the last stripe, mimics her every motion, every sliding muscle, the smallest twitch of her tail. How are she and her reflection correlated? The light, shining down on her narrow, slinky shoulders, bounces off them in all directions. Some of this light ends up in the eye of the beholder, either straight from her fur or, by a longer route, from tiger to mirror to eye. The beholder sees two tigers moving in perfectly opposite synchrony. Look closer. Look past the smoothness of that coat to see its hairs. Past its hairs to see the elaborate architectural arrangements of molecules that compose them, and then the atoms of which the molecules are made. Roughly a billionth of a meter wide, each atom is, to speak very loosely, its own solar system, with a dense center circled by distant electrons. At these levels, molecular, atomic, electronic, we are in the native land of quantum mechanics. The tigress, though large and vividly colored, must be near the mirror for a watcher to see two correlated cats. If she is in the jungle, a few yards separation would leave the mirror showing only undergrowth and swinging vines. Even out in the open, at a certain distance, the curvature of the earth would rise up to obscure mirror from tigress and decouple their synchrony. But the entangled particles Bell was talking about in his paper can act in unison with the whole universe in between. Quantum entanglement, as Bell would go on to explain in his paper, is not really like Bertelmann's socks. No one puzzles over how he always manages to pick different colored socks or how he pulls the socks onto his feet. But in quantum mechanics, there is no idiosyncratic brain choosing to coordinate distant particles, and it is hard not to compare how they do it to magic. In the real world, correlations are the result of local influences, unbroken chains of contact. One sheep butts another. There's a local influence. A lamb comes running to its mother's bleat after waves of air molecules hit each other in an entirely local domino effect, starting from her vocal cords and ending when they beat the tiny drum in the baby's ear in a pattern his brain recognizes as mom. Sheep scatter at the arrival of a coyote. The moving air has carried bits of coyote musk and dandruff into their nostrils, or the electromagnetic waves of light from the moon have bounced off the coyote's pelt and into the retinas of their eyes. Either way, it's all local, including the nerves firing in each sheep's brain to say, danger, and carrying the message to her muscles. Grown up, sold, and separated on different farms, twin lambs both still chew their cud after eating, and produce lambs that look eerily similar. These correlations are still local. No matter how far the lambs ultimately separate, their genetic material was laid down when they were a single egg inside their mother's womb. Bell liked to talk about twins. He would show a photograph of the pair of Ohio identical twins, both named Jim, separated at birth and then reunited at age 40, just as Bell was writing Bertelmann's socks. Their similarities were so striking that an institute for the study of twins was founded, appropriately enough, at the University of Minnesota in the Twin Cities. Both Jims were nail biters, who smoked the same brand of cigarettes and drove the same model and color of car. Their dogs were named Toy, their ex-wives Linda, and current wives Betty. They were married on the same day. One Jim named his son James Allen. His twin named his son James Allen. They both liked carpentry. One made miniature picnic tables and the other miniature rocking chairs. The correlations that Bell's theorem discusses are so obviously twin-like, so blatantly correlated, that the natural thing would be to imagine that they, like these lambs and Jims, have something approximating DNA. And that is where their mystery lies. For what the theorem shows is just how strange and non-local, spooky, those genes would have to be. The person who most clearly presented the intellectual puzzle of Bell's theorem to non-physicists was a solid-state physicist named David Merman, and he first became aware of it in 1979 from a Scientific American article by Bell's friend, Bernard Despagnat. Merman hailed from an opposite corner of the physics world from Bell, studying slow atoms chilled to a few degrees above absolute zero. But soon, Bell's hobby became his hobby, too. He boiled Bell's theorem down to something so simple that I could convey the argument using no mathematics beyond simple arithmetic and no quantum mechanics at all. From these musings arose something between a parable and a lecture demonstration, centering around a cartoon version of a three-part machine like the one that Bell described in Bertelmann's Socks. This machine can be viewed in two ways. It is a reified, more visual way to talk about the equations of quantum mechanics and their predictions and results. It is also an abstraction of an apparatus that, these days, may be found in any quantum optics lab. In the center is a box that, at the push of a button, emits a pair of particles, sending them in opposite directions. On either side of the box, and far from it, sit two detectors. Each has a lever or crank on one side that allows a person to realign its internal apparatus so that it measures the particle along a different axis. We can turn the crank from the normal setting, which measures the particle head-on, to the vertical setting, to the horizontal setting. Each detector also has a light on top that, upon receipt of a particle, flashes either red or green. Merman invites us to imagine that we have just come upon this machine with no further information. Tinkering, we press start. And shortly thereafter, each detector flashes red or green. Garnering as much information as possible, we crank the detectors between the three settings, all the while pressing the button and noting which lights come on. Over several hours, we accumulate thousands and thousands of apparently random results. But the results are not random. They are precisely what quantum mechanics predicts for certain two-particle situations. Looking them over, we find that we can divide the data into two cases. Case 1, when both detectors are on the same setting, they always flash the same color, both green or both red. Case 2, when the detectors are on different settings, they flash red on one side and green on the other at least 3/4 of the time. In other words, the same color, both green or both red, flashes not more than 25% of the time. These statistics, Merman remarks, may seem harmless enough, but some scrutiny reveals them to be as surprising as anything seen in a magic show, and leads to similar suspicions of hidden wires, mirrors, or confederates under the floor. Consider the case when the detectors are on the same setting. The same lights always flash. Given the unconnectedness of the detectors, there is one, and I would think only one, extremely simple way to explain this behavior, Merman writes. We need only suppose that some property of each particle, such as its speed, size, or shape, determines the color its detector will flash for each of the three switch positions. They share some kind of genes. Twin particles make twin lights flash. This is such a reasonable explanation that it is disheartening to realize that the very same data prove it to be dead wrong. If we indeed have twin particles, with properties that cause them to react identically when detected, then we can predict all the conceivable results such particles might produce on this machine. The way to make this prediction is first to list the different kinds of possible particles. One pair would trigger the red light when the machine is on its normal setting, and the green light for vertical or horizontal. Another, the green light only for the horizontal setting, and the red light otherwise. Yet another pair would trigger the red light no matter what setting, and so on, in 8 different combinations. Having written these down, we can reason our way through each pair's reactions to all 9 possible pairs of settings, each time getting one of 4 results. 2 red flashes, 2 green flashes, a green on the right, and a red on the left, or vice versa. What we will find, if we write down all the possible permutations, is that particles such as these, that is, particles that carry genes prepared to react in predetermined ways to any eventuality, could never produce the results we actually got. Case 1 is the same as before. When both detectors are on the same setting, the same lights always flash. But case 2 is very different. When the detectors are on different settings, they flash red on one side and green on the other less than 2/3 of the time. In other words, the same color flashes 33 1/3% of the time or more. 33 1/3% of the time, not 25%. This is the kind of result known as Bell's inequality. It lay hidden for so long, partly because no one, until Bell, thought to solve the equations of quantum mechanics for the situations in which the detectors were not aligned, and compare these with the predictions for particles with predetermined attributes. More than 40 years after Bell's discovery, the completely mystifying, unanswered question remains. If there are no connections between the detectors, and if what is arriving at them is not a pair of particles bearing identical genes, what in the world causes identical lights to flash when the detectors are on identical settings? In a sense, Bell's argument in his theorem is really simple. To Bell it was, certainly, but there's something about it, as he said, that nobody follows originally. Because of this, Bell himself restated it in many ways, from his original five-line mathematical proof in 1964 to several formulations that rely on analogy, more than one of which are contained in Bertelmann's Socks. His friend, Bernard d'Espagnat, for example, humorously gave this analogy to Bell's inequality. The number of young non-smokers plus the number of woman smokers of all ages is greater than or equal to the total number of young women, smokers and otherwise. It is a logical statement this trivial, a tautology, that quantum theory flouts. The problem is not the logic, but the premises. That it makes sense simultaneously to assign gender, age, and tobacco use to a person. Instead, in quantum theory, the whole seems to be greater than the sum of its parts. The recoil of one ram from the headbutt of another, the lamb trotting up to the call of his mother, the arrival of the coyote and departure of the sheep. For all these correlations, there is a cause and effect. They all take place in time. The ram's hard head moves as fast as the ram's muscles and hooves can carry him, covering perhaps 10 meters in a second, roughly 20 miles per hour. The call of the mother sheep travels both faster and farther, about a kilometer in 3 seconds, nearly 750 miles per hour, on a chilly spring day. The speed of the diffusion of the telltale smell of the coyote is slower and more arbitrary, and, even more than the ewe's call, the diffusion of this musk is at the mercy of the air. Local contingencies of temperature, pressure, and any changes of these that form a wind all speed or slow its arrival in the quivering nostrils of a sheep. The signal to the eye is the fastest one, since it occurs near the speed of light, almost 300,000 kilometers per second. Compare this to the speed of sound, 1/3 of a kilometer per second. This speed is almost inconceivably fast. A ray of light could circle the Earth 7 times in a second, but it is, like the other local influences, a speed. It is not instantaneous. With the possibility ruled out that Bell's strangely connected particles start out complete with their synchronized instructions, we might wonder if instead there is some kind of signaling going on. Upon reaching the detector with the green and red lights, one particle might somehow communicate with the other so they can coordinate the results. On a visit to Paris in 1979, John Bell explained the problem with this idea by telling a whimsical story about French TV. It has been feared that television is responsible for the disturbing decline of birth rate in France. He was speaking to a group of physicists at the University of Paris South in Orsay, who must have wondered what this had to do with quantum physics. It is quite unclear which of the two main programs, Bell used the word in its old-fashioned sense as channel, France 1 and 2, both originating in Paris, is more to blame. It has been advocated that deliberate experiments be done, say, in Lille and Lyon, to investigate the matter. The local mayors might decide, by tossing coins each morning, which one of the two programs would be locally relayed during the day. Bell noted that after enough time, one could get a pretty good sense for the number of conceptions in Lille and Lyon, respectively, after exposure to one or the other channels, a joint distribution of probability involving both towns. You might at first think it pointless to consider such a joint distribution, expecting it to separate trivially into independent factors, Bell continued. But a moment of reflection will convince that this will not be so. For example, the weather in the two towns is correlated, although imperfectly. On fine evenings, people do not watch television, They walk in the parks and are moved by the beauty of the trees, the monuments, and of one another. This is especially so on Sundays. The investigators must recognize such extraneous factors affecting both towns and remove their effects from the analysis. It would be remarkable if the towns were still correlated after the investigators had dealt with these extraneous causal factors. It would be even more remarkable if the choice of program in Lille proved to be a causal factor in Lyon, or if the choice of program in Lyon proved to be a causal factor in Lille, if the result of showing France 1 in Lyon produced a spike in pregnancies in Lille. But according to quantum mechanics, situations presenting just such a dilemma can be contrived. Moreover, he came to the center of the problem, the peculiar long-range influence in question seems to go faster than light. And that is impossible, as the theory of relativity shows. Space and time are not constant realities unaffected by anything. Space, Einstein said, is merely what we measure with a ruler. Time is what we measure with a clock. And as it turns out, the faster an object goes, the more it compresses and the slower ticks any clock it might carry, for example, its heartbeat. In fact, it compresses just enough and its clock slows down just enough that it can never reach the speed of light. Every day, accelerators like the one that John and Mary Bell helped design, full of particles moving close to the speed of light, bear out in precise detail Einstein's amazing predictions. 299,800 kilometers per second is the universe's absolute speed limit. 2 years after the Orsay talk, as Bell was publishing Bertelmann's Socks, a young experimental physicist there named Alain Aspect, with an auspiciously Hercule Poirot-esque mustache, was about to test if such a long-range influence really must be faster than the speed of light. Rigging up something very much like the Bell-Merman machine, he found that the mysterious correlations remained, unfazed no matter how fast he switched the settings on the detectors. Physical signals traveling at mere light speed could not explain the results. So, there are no genes, and there is no signaling. The world is entangled in a beautiful and mysterious way. At the beginning of the 21st century, after three-quarters of a century of coexistence with the idea, there is still no clear explanation of its magic. But a change is in the air. One of the early people to think of trying to build something out of entanglement was Richard Feynman, in 1981, the greatest and most famous physicist alive. He had actually been thinking about Bell's theorem along the same lines as Merman had. "One of the most beautiful papers in physics that I know of is yours in the American Journal of Physics," Feynman wrote to Merman in 1984 when he had read it. "All my mature life, I have been trying to distill the strangeness of quantum mechanics into simpler and simpler circumstances," he explained, which had led him to craft a similar but twice as complicated Gedanken demonstration. "When your ideally pristine presentation appeared." Feynman had computers on his mind, and he had instantly seen that Bell's theorem prohibited them from simulating nature on the quantum level. Characteristically, he viewed this as an opportunity rather than a problem. At the Massachusetts Institute of Technology that same year, as Aspect tweaked his machinery, Feynman brought Bell's inequality before a meeting of the best computer scientists in the world. He challenged them to produce a new kind of computer. This might hardly be recognizable to us as a computer. In fact, the first one made at the end of the 20th century was a liquid of specially engineered molecules in a tiny vial. But in whatever form it takes, the person using it to compute will do so by manipulating the states of quantum particles. Most important to Feynman, a quantum computer would use the magic of entanglement and bring us to an understanding of it in the process. Not long after Feynman gave this speech, a few brilliant minds proved some of the things such a computer might be able to do. Most significant to non-physicists, a quantum computer could crack all the codes that the security of our banks, government, and the internet is based on. as experimental quantum physics groups in physics departments all over the world turn their attention to the building of a quantum computer, entanglement remains a mystery. But it is a mystery that gets better known all the time. Physicists are beginning to look at the magical correlations at something as fundamental and worth fathoming as energy or information. Famously, it was through machine building that scientists began to understand both these fundamental ideas. In the 19th century, advances in understanding energy were inseparable from the building and running of steam engines. In the 20th century, the rise of computers was inextricably intertwined with the rise of information theory. In the 21st century, hands-on work on the quantum computer and quantum cryptography, another entanglement-based miracle, will make us both more comfortable and more awed at entanglement. But it was the 20th century that first encountered entanglement, and to tell the story of entanglement is to tell much of the story of quantum physics itself. The story of entanglement begins near the start of the century with a suspicion of the spookiness of the quantum theory. For centuries, physics had seemed to be on a relentless march to total understanding of the world. The dawn of the 20th century brought the news that the deeper we delved into both matter and light, the more mysteries we would find. The Arguments, 1909 to 1935. Chapter 2, Quantized Light, September 1909 to June 1913. During the autumn in Salzburg, a hot, dry wind called the Föhn sweeps down the slopes of the Alps and through the chilly air of the city. It evaporates all haze and fog so that faraway things appear suddenly clear. But the atmosphere is heavy and unpleasantly unseasonal. People blame the Föhn for their headaches and irritability. Albert Einstein, a rumpled and large-eyed 30-year-old in a straw hat, about to change his official career from patent clerk to professor, came to Salzburg in late September of 1909 for his first physics conference. With its pale stucco facades and copper-roofed towers, the city is known for its particularly beautiful light, and light was what was on Einstein's mind. Rooster-tail feathers and hummingbirds, the pearly inner chambers of shells and the wing cases of beetles, soap bubbles and oil slicks, thick glass and dappled sunlight through gaps between leaves. All these, examined closely, show light as a wave. It does not rain down on us like the Schnellregen or straight string rain downpours of Salzburg. It ripples and interferes. While the actual interference is invisible, its calling card is striking. Precise bands of darkness in places that a string rain of light would illuminate, and precise bands of light in places that the imagined downpour of light drops would leave in shadow. Color, moreover, is purely a wave phenomenon. It is the number of times a light wave rises and falls per second, and each color bends differently when it strikes liquid or striated surfaces, producing the iridescence of the soap bubble or beetle. The understanding of all these phenomena was the climax of centuries of study of electromagnetic radiation. Light is merely the visible stretch of the electromagnetic spectrum, ranging from radio waves bigger than a house to X-rays and gamma rays smaller than an atom. Then Einstein, in 1905, came across the beginning of a great mystery. Sometimes light, so clearly a wave, seemed to act like drops or particles. This mystery was as strange as the discovery of unicorn horns on Arctic beaches. Such a discovery encourages some to dismiss it entirely, while others proclaim the existence of magic horned horses. Only a few will search for the narwhal, the Arctic whale to whom the horn belongs. Einstein was going to Salzburg to tell his fellow physicists, whom he had never met, that light was made of neither waves nor particles, but some currently incomprehensible fusion of the two. But the real narwhal is a strange beast, stranger than the mythical unicorn. Einstein was embarking on a quest to understand each particle of light and matter as possessing its own independence, disentangled from all the others, its own local reality, its own unique, separable state. This 50-year search for separability led him again and again to its nemesis, entanglement. And the clarity with which he reported his unwanted results made this unsuccessful quest one of the most fruitful investigations of the 20th century. The year before the conference, Einstein's focus on light had reached an intense pitch. "I am incessantly busy with the question of the constitution of radiation," he wrote in 1908, engaging in arguments by letter with H. A. Lawrence of Leiden, Holland, and Max Planck of Berlin, the two preeminent theoretical physicists in the world, both more than two decades older than Einstein. He found Planck "an utterly honest man who thinks of others rather than himself," and because of this, he would show Planck more steadfast loyalty than he gave either of his own wives. "He has, however," Einstein decided in 1908, "one fault. He is clumsy in finding his way about foreign trains of thought." Lawrence, on the other hand, seemed to Einstein in 1908 astonishingly profound, and by 1909 he was writing, "I admire this man as no other. I would say I love him." Einstein and Lawrence believed that Planck, in the last month of the 19th century, had turned physics on its head. It had all started with light in a box, an image to which Einstein would return repeatedly. In 1900, after years of work, Planck had come up with a formula that predicted, for any given temperature, the energy carried by each color of light inside a box. The box could be any size or shape, as long as it was empty and could hold heat. In order to get the correct formula, Planck had to count energy in quanta of a certain size, symbolized by HV. Quantum was nothing mysterious yet. In German, it just means amount, while V stood for the color, that is, frequency of the light, and H was a new, tiny, constant number. Then came Einstein's discovery in 1905 that the data for bluer, high-frequency light showed that Planck's discovery was not just a counting device. Ultraviolet light, X-rays, and gamma rays behaved, in or out of the box, as if actually built from mutually independent energy quanta, atoms of light. The man whose mathematical analysis they were all using to attack this problem was Ludwig Boltzmann of Vienna, who had done more than anyone to demonstrate logically that matter was built of atoms. But he lost himself in his ever-present depression and committed suicide in 1906 at the age of 62. As that tragedy unfolded, his student, a 25-year-old named Paul Ehrenfest, showed that Planck's new formula had introduced something completely new that could not be derived from, or even harmonized with, any physics that had gone before. A pure wave theory led to wildly wrong predictions for high-energy, high-frequency light. Ehrenfest dubbed the situation the ultraviolet catastrophe. "This quantum question is so uncommonly important and difficult," Einstein wrote in 1908, "that it should concern everyone." At the time, it hardly concerned anyone aside from himself, Planck, Lawrence, and Ehrenfest. Early in May of 1909, Lawrence wrote Einstein a long and thoughtful letter criticizing Einstein's particles of light. "I must have expressed myself unclearly in regard to the light quanta," Einstein replied late that month. "That is to say, I am not at all of the opinion that one should think of light as being composed of mutually independent quanta localized in relatively small spaces." What strange things would mutually dependent or non-local quanta be? Einstein very much hoped that the truth, with further digging, would set him free of such chimeras. On the way to Salzburg from his home in Switzerland, he had stopped in Munich to see the only schoolteacher who had really inspired him, a Dr. Rus, who taught fourth and fifth grade languages and history. The perpetually amused, stubborn-as-a-mule patent officer standing before his old teacher had already accomplished much of what would later make him the most famous man in the world. He had already shown that, though motion is relative to a reference point, the speed of light and the laws of physics are not. He had already shown that energy and matter were transmutable, E equals mc squared. But Dr. Roos saw only Einstein's frayed clothes, thought he must be there to ask for money, and sent him on his way. An inauspicious prelude to his first conference. "It is my opinion," Einstein explained, looking out at the assembled physicists in Salzburg, "that the next phase of the development of theoretical physics will bring us a theory of light that can be interpreted as a kind of fusion of the wave and particle theories." The purpose of his speech, he explained, would be to justify this opinion and to show that a deep change in our conception about the nature and constitution of light is indispensable. He showed an increasingly skeptical, bewildered audience that Planck's formula actually required light to be a particle as well as a wave. Planck immediately stood up after the mystified clapping died down. He had come from a family of theologians on both sides, and he himself, with his serious eyes, dignified mustache, and thin frame, was in many ways the pastor of German physicists. "I will restrict myself, naturally, to the points where I have a different opinion from that of the speaker," he said. He felt that Einstein had made a step that is, in my opinion, not yet necessary. In any case, I think that we should first try to transfer the problem of quantum theory into the area of interaction between matter and radiating energy. The belligerent Johannes Stark stood up in pince-nez and a sweeping mustache that dwarfed his handsome face. He was a 35-year-old Bavarian experimentalist, and, along with Planck, he had merited one of the few footnotes in Einstein's light quantum paper of 1905. Einstein, who was not sensitive enough to be bothered by difficult people, seemed to have made a friend of Stark, who usually made only enemies. For a decade, he would be Einstein's only light quantum follower. But as Einstein's fame grew, Stark's jealousy became a mania. When Hitler rose to power, Stark would lead the cry for Einstein's blood and for the removal of Jewish physics from Germany. In 1909, Stark recognized Einstein's valid point. "Originally, I too was of the same opinion," he said to Planck. "However, there is one phenomenon which forces us to think of electromagnetic radiation as separated from matter and concentrated in space. Röntgen rays, as X-rays were then called, can still act concentratedly, with their full force, on a single atom, even at up to 10 meters. The opposite of a wave, diffusing out into the world in ever-widening circles." "There is something unique to Röntgen rays," Planck agreed. "Stark has mentioned something in favor of the quantum theory. I wish to add a remark against it," he continued. "Most light behavior, most strikingly interference, can hardly be explained by particles." "If a quantum interferes with itself," Planck said, "it must have a spatial extension of hundreds of thousands of wavelengths. How could a string rain of particles produce those neat bands of light and shadow? Interference demands a wave explanation." Stark responded confidently, "The interference phenomena would probably be different with very low radiation density." It would be 3/4 of a century before this reasonable statement could be shown to be false, when experiments would demonstrate that a single light quantum could indeed interfere with itself. Einstein stepped in, describing what he would later call his Gespensterfelder, ghost waves. "An electron," he noted, "is surrounded by an electric field, and each quantum might similarly emanate a field through which these ghost waves would ripple." On this hopeful note, the meeting ended. In the ensuing years, Einstein tried to make this separable one-wave-per-particle description work. The reason for the failure of this idea would slowly emerge over the decades with ever greater clarity. Entanglement, where two particles are not really separable because a single wave describes them. "I have not yet found a solution of the light quantum question," Einstein wrote that New Year's Eve. "All the same, I will try to see if I cannot work out this favorite problem of mine." By December 1910, things were no better. "The enigma of radiation will not yield." In the spring of 1911, he wrote to his best friend, the engineer Michel Angelo Besso, I do not ask any more whether these quanta really exist, nor do I attempt any longer to construct them, since I now know my brain is incapable of advancing in that direction. He had spent 3.5 years exclusively on light quanta and felt that he had gotten nowhere. In June 1911, he turned to a new problem, which would bring him his greatest success. At present, he wrote in 1912, I occupy myself exclusively with the problem of gravitation. But the non-separable, and hence uncountable, quanta remained in the back of his mind. Even as he repeated that one cannot believe in the existence of countable quanta, since the interference properties of light are not compatible with it, he yearned for the straightforwardness of separability. I still prefer the honest theory of quanta to the compromises found so far to replace it. It was a warm June evening in Zurich in 1913. Einstein was sitting in the garden of a coffee shop, an empty mug before him on the table. With him were two of his lifelong friends, Ehrenfest and Max von Laue. They had just come from a colloquium on von Laue's spectacular discovery in Munich the year before. A crystal of blue copper sulfate with its regular rows of atoms, von Laue realized, could diffract X-rays. That is, the gaps between the atoms would cause the X-rays to fan out in concentric ripples on the other side, as waves do. These ripples, emerging from between each row of atoms in the crystal, then interfered with each other, wave peak joining with wave peak, to make a wave bigger than the sum of their heights, or trough, canceling out peak, producing nothing where two waves were before. Von Laue had immediately sent the photographs to Einstein, who wrote back congratulating him. On your wonderful success. Your experiment is one of the finest things to have happened in physics. How Einstein's quanta fit into this picture was still a mystery. Handsome, thoughtful, and upright, even later in the midst of the maelstrom of the Third Reich, von Laue was the son of a peripatetic Prussian officer whose career had sent Max from town to town, school to school throughout his childhood. In 1903, Laue had received his Ph.D. under Planck, whose first act was to introduce Laue to relativity. The enthralled student then spent his summer vacation hiking through the Swiss mountains to meet its author at the patent office in Bern. After he got over his shock that Einstein was a 24-year-old like himself, the two talked for hours over cigars so awful that Laue let his accidentally fall in the river. Already famous in Berlin for the high speeds at which he flew down the city streets on his motorbike, in 1911, Laue published a book on relativity that Einstein regarded as a little masterpiece. Ehrenfest, on the other hand, had faced the quantum head-on ever since hearing a 1903 speech of Lorentz's. Although often suffering from depression, Ehrenfest usually hit it with his exuberance, and his brilliant criticism would make him the conscience of physics. He was an unconventional Viennese who had settled in St. Petersburg with his wife Tatiana, a Russian physicist. But in chaotic pre-revolutionary Russia, much as he loved it, there were no university positions open to him as a foreigner, a Jew, and an atheist. In 1912, just as he had decided to move to Zurich to be near Einstein, which is what Laue had done the same year, Lorentz called him to be his successor at Leiden University, a place he would make supremely homelike to hundreds of visiting physicists while never feeling at home himself. Short and broad-shouldered in his Russian high-necked belted tunic, his deep-set dark eyes sparkling under his bristling black hair, he would emphasize the crux of complicated scientific concepts with words like, "That's where the frog jumps into the water," or, in homage to Einstein, "There's the patent claim." Laue had warned Ehrenfest the first time he met Einstein, "You should be careful that Einstein doesn't talk you to death. He loves to do that, you know." But Ehrenfest could hold his own. On this, his second visit, Ehrenfest and Einstein had been talking for 5 days straight, walking alone in the hazy, hot hills. A few days before, an eager crowd of physicists had joined them on a local mountain, while Einstein explained his work, Ehrenfest asking ever sharper questions until it made sense. His jubilant shout, I have understood it!" still rang in von Laue's ears. Ehrenfest was now describing his struggles with the quantum theory to Einstein, who nodded sympathetically. "The more success the quantum theory has, the sillier it looks." Ehrenfest turned to von Laue. "Did he tell you about the park in Prague?" Von Laue shook his head. "Well, when I came to visit Einstein in Prague a year ago..." "Einstein, you tell it." "My office had a really quite nice view of a park with trees and gardens," said Einstein. "And people would walk in it, some deep in thought, others gesticulating intensely at each other in groups." Einstein grinned. "The strange thing was, it was only women in the morning and only men in the evening. And when I asked what was this place, they told me, 'It's the Bohemian Insane Asylum.'" Ehrenfest turned to von Laue. "And he said, 'Those are the madmen who do not occupy themselves with the quantum theory.'" Chapter 3. The Quantized Atom. November 1913. The late November fog accompanied Max von Laue and Otto Stern most of the way up the Utleberg. It was 5 months after Ehrenfest's visit. They were hiking the little mountain on this gloomy day because they knew that its peak was above the clouds, in the sun. That morning, in the fog-bound streets, Stern and von Laue had seen yellow placards reading Utleberg Hell, Mount Utle Light. Laue and Stern had only recently become locals. Laue, a professor at the University of Zurich, and Stern, a lecturer at the ETH. The letters stand for Eidgenössische Technische Hochschule, the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, but it is always known by its initials, the ETH. Like the Alsatian Laue, Stern had grown up on the much-disputed fringes of Bismarck's booming German Empire, in Silesia, the as-yet-unknown and ordinary town of Auschwitz sat on its border. Stern was a decade younger than von Laue, chunky, long-chinned, radiating good humor. He would brilliantly occupy the border between theory and experiment, but he was so clumsy that he would do anything to avoid handling the more breakable equipment once he had become a professor, with assistants to do it for him. "Even if it was toppling over, you do less damage if you let the thing fall than if you try to catch it," he would explain, gesturing with his cigar. Spending his own money to join Einstein in Prague in 1911, he had been Einstein's sole confidant there. The memories of those beautiful days would bring tears to his eyes when Stern was an old man, exiled by the Nazis on the other side of the world. On top of the Utleberg, taking deep breaths of the cold air while sweat chilled between their shoulder blades, they looked out across the white sea of fog. The city behind them had vanished. Instead, they saw the thunderous Alps, the snowy trinity of the Eiger, the Monk, and the Virgin, and the precipitous dark steeple of the Finsteraarhorn. The two men made a funny silhouette against this view, the short and semispherical Stern beside the tall and angular von Laue. They were talking about the atom, as everyone they knew seemed to be. Ever since it became clear in 1911 that the atom was something like a tiny solar system, its sun, the positively charged nucleus, exerting a constant electrical pull on its planets, the negatively charged electrons, there were problems. A charged object, like an electron, is inseparable from the electric field it emanates. If it moves, it generates a magnetic field too. And if it changes its speed, speeding up, slowing down, or turning, that change makes a wave in the electric and magnetic field surrounding it. This electromagnetic wave is what we call light. The electrons, charged and orbiting the heart of the atom, should be making constant light wave ripples in their electromagnetic fields, leaking energy with each wave until every atom in the universe goes flat like a punctured tire. This, of course, does not happen. In 1913, a few weeks before Stern and von Laue climbed the Utleberg, the theoretical problem of the inexplicably stable atom had been declared solved by an unknown 28-year-old Danish physicist, Niels Bohr, just returned home to Copenhagen after a year in Manchester, England. It had taken him 71 dense pages and his explanation was illogical. Rather than radiating light all the time, Bohr said the electrons would emit light only when they made a kind of ineffable transition, the famous quantum jump. These jumps, or leaps, were nothing like the smooth bounding of a cat. They were a baffling, quantized, all-or-nothing disappearance in one orbit and emergence in another, like Earth suddenly materializing in the orbit of Mars. The quantum leaps alone were like nothing that had ever happened in a physical theory before. But just as unsettling was the frequency of light that the leaping electron emitted. We perceive the frequency of light as color, but the concept of frequency applies to anything that cycles, from literally round objects like wheels to things like the seasons that recur in a cyclical way. The frequency of a carousel, for example, is the number of times per minute the spotted pony with your little sister on it passes while you stand and wave. Inside the carousel, a record player cranks out a tinkly band organ tune. The frequency of the record is its number of rotations per minute, RPM, which is directly related to the frequency of the sound produced. If the operator happens to set the turntable at a slow 33 1/3 RPMs to play a 45 RPM record, the tinkling sound will deepen into a tired pizzicato, while the opposite mistake will produce a manic speed jingle. But in Bohr's atom, the frequency of the electron's orbit is not the same as the frequency of the light it emits. Incredibly, it is a single, pure frequency equal to the difference between the energies of the starting and ending orbits, divided by Planck's constant, h, as if the electron, radiating the light, already knew where it was going to stop. "It's just absurd. I don't think it's physics at all," said von Laue, finally, turning from the view. "He has simply stabilized the atom by fiat." Stern grinned. "The dictator." Von Laue laughed a little in his frustration. They sat staring again at the peaks in the distance. Then they both turned to each other and said, "Have you talked to Einstein?" "At this last colloquium when they presented Bohr's theory," von Laue said, "I stood up at the end and said," he looked at Stern with a practical expression on his face, "but this is nonsense. If an electron is going in a circular orbit, it has to radiate light." Stern nodded. "But Einstein, he said, 'Very curious. There must be something to it.'" Von Laue gave Stern a quick glance. "He said that he didn't believe it was pure chance that the Rydberg constant could be predicted so accurately in terms of basic constants." The Rydberg constant had been for 30 years an unexplained number in the equation predicting the colors of light each element of the periodic table might emit. Bohr's preposterous theory had accidentally and effortlessly yielded this heretofore arbitrary number, producing meaning where before there had only been mandate. "Well," von Laue finally said, "when he really thinks about it, he won't like the Bohr theory." "I agree," said Stern. "This dictatorial decision, laying out flight paths and ordering inexplicable jumps for the electrons, it might seem successful right now, but it's not physics." With a sardonic expression, von Laue commented, "Someone should stand up and stop this nonsense." Stern, with a mock elegiac tone in his voice, harked back to the fabled 14th century birth of Swiss democracy. "The lone man with two arrows. Where is Wilhelm Tell? Where are the men of the Rutli Oath?" Getting into the spirit of Schiller's famous play, von Laue quoted from it. "No, there is a limit to the tyrant's power." He and Stern were unwilling to accept a dictator, no matter how benevolent. They both were laughing now. "Do you solemnly swear, Max Laue," Stern grinned and corrected himself, "Max von Laue, to give up physics if Bohr turns out to be right?" Max's father had been bestowed with hereditary nobility that year, hence the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.